Hope everybody's doing well. Thank you for coming out tonight. I'm looking forward to a good conference together. My name is Andy Hayner, and I am a regional director with John G. Lake Ministries. How many of you have heard of John G. Lake? I've seen quite a few hands go up. He's an interesting guy. He lived about the 1900s, turn of the century, pretty much close up to World War I, World War II days, about 19, I'm not a great history guy, about 30s, 40s was when he had a lot of his ministry. So John Lake was a missionary to South Africa, saw God do amazing things, so much to the point that he was being accused of exaggerating. So they stopped all his funding. They sent some people over there to investigate, and they said the half has not been told. If anything, they were underestimating. He was there for about 8 years, came back to the United States, went to Spokane, Washington, and literally shut down a hospital because he was training up. He was getting so many people healed and set so many people free. That the hospitals were not having enough business.
There's people in the nursery can't hear you at all, and so.
You know, we were having technical difficulties. Did he get it fixed? Okay. Perfect.
Now people can hear you.
Now they can hear me?
Thank you.
I'm happy to do that. Hey, nursery. All right, guys. Sorry about that. We got that all fixed. All right. So, I've kind of jumped right into things. I don't really like to do that. Probably should do a little housekeeping stuff. So we're going to be here tonight till 9 o'clock. Tomorrow night we'll be back here at 6:45. We'll go till 9 o'clock again. Then we're here all day Saturday for training during the day. Actually, tomorrow, if there are people that have the ability to either have the day off or have come in from out of town for this conference, there's an optional outreach training from 10 to 4. So we'll start here. We'll do some little bit of training so that we can learn how that we can release the kingdom of God out on the streets and then as a lifestyle. You'll hear a lot of my testimonies. They're at Walmart. They're out on the streets meeting people in college campuses, stuff like that. It's where people are. We don't have to have the worship service get the mood just right for God to show up. How many of you know God is here?
Amen.
And He's not looking to be in a certain mood for Him to be willing to do stuff. He is eternally present. He is the same today, yesterday, and forever. And so a lot of times we're trying to get ourselves psyched up oftentimes. But Jesus wasn't like that, was He? He was able to, when He's walking down the street and somebody says, "Come heal my daughter," He says, "Let's do it." Right? When somebody says, "Lord, I'm blind and I want to see again," He goes, "Great, receive your sight." He didn't have to get the boys playing the band. You know, I love good worship, don't you? I love enjoying the presence of God and singing His praises, and there's some good in that. I'm not trying to disparage any of that. So I just want to encourage you that as you listen to me, sometimes I may say things a little different than you've heard them. I may, in order to draw some contrast, I might set some things aside, you know, but don't hear me as criticizing things. It's not about trying to tell people, you know, that this is wrong and that's bad and the other thing. Usually everybody, I believe, is waking up really doing the best they can with what they've been taught. Amen. How many people you know? I mean, there's a lot of different things out there, but for the most part, there are people that love Jesus, that have integrity in their heart, that want to serve Him. People aren't waking up every morning saying, "Hey, how can I live a defeated life and help screw up other people's lives too?" Right? People are trying to understand the Bible and trying to live it out. So I believe that what's holding a lot of us back is the same things that was holding me back for a lot of my Christian life. I grew up Roman Catholic. Well, I didn't even know Jesus. My family didn't know Jesus. We had a church building that we went to on Sunday mornings. And when I went to college, I stopped going to church. And I told my parents, I said, "Why do I have to go to church if God doesn't?" You know, that's a good question. But for me, I never met God there. And so, but there was one night And my dorm room, that I met God, that God came to me in a big way, that some seeds that had been planted in my heart through the Word, just listening to it and it being read in the Catholic Church. How many of you know they got the Word that's read and they say, "Thus saith the Lord," you know, and they do the little sign. I was doing that, but I never paid much attention to it. And here I am praying, "Lord, what is the whole purpose of this thing? You know, with me in charge of my life, it's going nowhere." And all of a sudden, it's like God hacked my computer. I wasn't expecting an answer. You know, I'm just talking out into the wide world here. And all of a sudden, I have this sense of presence come over me. And I had what the Bible calls the fear of the Lord. And then all of a sudden, within me, I hear this phrase, "What good is it for a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul?" And I was like, "That's right." I felt so small and like I've been stupid. I've been living my whole life to gain things in this world, to get the girls to like me, to get my parents' approval, to get the coaches to like me, to be successful. And I was doing pretty good at it. My problem was I was doing really good at everything I wanted to do, and I still wasn't happy. You know, some people, they fail and they find God. For me, I was failing at life even though it looked like I was succeeding, you know. And then that night, I received Jesus Christ. I put my faith in Him as my Lord and Savior. I was like, my prayer to receive Christ was, yeah, that was it. And I knew right then that God had forgiven me of all my sins. He'd come into my life. He changed me, made me new. So the next morning, I asked a friend of mine for a Bible. "Hey, could you get me I think you have a Bible. Do you have an extra one I could borrow?" They gave it to me. I started reading it, and God's Word really started coming alive to me. I started making Christian friends, and you might hear it come out every now and again. I have a little bit of a southern accent from time to time. And the more I preach and the more sweet tea I drink, the more it comes back to me. My parents were raised in Illinois. My dad was in Pontiac, Illinois. My mom was in Evanston near Chicago. And they were in the Air Force. We moved around a lot. So I was raised in Alabama from a third grade on. So Sweet Home Alabama. I sing that all winter long, man, in Wisconsin. I live in Madison, Wisconsin. I've got a wife and three children. Awesome wife. She homeschools our children. And they all love Jesus. And they all love me. And respect me because my wife loves me. She got the kids on. We got Jesus holding us all together. It's amazing. So, what happened after that is I started making some friends. And down there, most people were coming out of a Baptist type of background, right? So they have a strong belief in the authority of the Word of God, that you need Jesus to be saved. Amen? And everybody prays a prayer, and then some people, that's the last they ever do, you know? "I prayed my prayer, and I got baptized in water, and phew, glad I got that done. Now we can go party." That's some of their mentality. For me, it was not like that at all. It was, "Man, I'm done with religion. I'm done with myself. All I want is Jesus. And He's come into me and given me a brand new life. I want to follow Him. I want to know Him." And so I had some great Christian friends, and they were teaching me, you know, how to study the Word for myself. And I started doing this, and that's all I wanted. And then I started seeing these really cool things about Jesus said that whoever believes in me, the works that I do, he'll do also. And even greater than these. Because I go to the Father, amen? John 14, verse 12, right? And I was like, "Hey, Jesus, this is what Jesus says. Does that mean we get to do miracles and signs and wonders and heal the sick and raise the dead and cast out demons?" And they said, "No, well, you know, you used to be." Jesus said, "Whoever believes in me used to be able to do that." I was like, "No, I didn't say that." You know, but all the examples that I had around me were putting the brakes on. You know, they're saying, "This is what the Word says," but, you know, they had found their theological ways to kind of work their ways around all those things. It happened for a period of time, but after we got the Bible, this was the best explanation I had, that it happened for a period of time so that people could know that these are the people speaking the truth, and then the Bible came. And now that we've got the Bible, we don't need any more of the Holy Spirit anymore. Well, my buddy back there, Wade, he's wearing one of the shirts that we have on our book table, the little Godfident t-shirt. I met Wade about a year ago, and it was interesting. As I got to know Wade, he was sharing some of his story, and he shared with me. He said, "You know, Andy, I grew up in a church that every Sunday they said, you need to read the Bible every day. You need to read the Bible every day. But in the next breath, they would say, God doesn't do those things anymore. God doesn't do those things anymore. God doesn't do those things anymore. So after a while, I was like, well, why read the Bible anymore if God doesn't do anything that he used to do in the Bible? I mean, that's logic for you, right? So then he slipped away, and then he started coming back to the Lord and growing. It was really neat. Wade went with me on a mission trip to Kenya last year. And man, we saw a lot of things, a lot of really cool things happen over there. So let me finish up my story, though, because I came to a place where I believed the Word of God. I went to seminary. Sorry, I did. I went to seminary, but I went to seminary because I wanted to understand what the Bible really said, because I thought, man, we're missing something here. And if I could just figure out what the Bible really said, then I could do it, and then everything would be different. And I really wanted to find out what that little phrase meant, in Christ, right? Mm-hmm. Amen? Like, because that's the key to everything. Paul made a big deal about we're in Christ and Christ is in you. And then John in his epistles, in Christ. I was like, what does it mean? You know, have you ever read that? You're like, what does it mean? And then you think, well, I don't quite understand it. So you think, it's got to be in Greek, right? So then you go enroll in seminary and you got to learn all these Greek classes. And you know what I found out? What in Christ means in Greek? It means in Christ. It was not, you didn't get any extra insight from the Greek on this one. This is spiritually discerned. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. Well, I still felt like I didn't quite understand it, but I still knew this was the key. My wife and I, by that time, we had our first child. He was 3 months old, Simeon. We went to Turkey as missionaries. We thought for the rest of our life, we were there for 2 years, and my wife got very sick. We weren't able to get any medical cure over there or even a diagnosis. How many of you know that sometimes if the enemy can't stop you spiritually and bring you into compromise and bring you into confusion and doubt, that he'll take the battle to the mat in the physical, won't he?
Yes.
He'll find your opening. He'll find where you have doubt, where you're not equipped in the kingdom, and he'll go for that place, right? Well, he attacked my wife. I didn't see it as an attack at that time. You know what I saw it as? God working out his mysterious plan. Amen?
Yeah.
Do you understand that? That I had been theologicalized to the point that I believed that everything that happened is directly attributable to the fact that this is God's will and God's plan for your life. Now, you might be believing that, and if that's you, this is going to really help you, okay? Because it's hard when you have people dying of cancer, when you have people, when you have afflictions in your body and things that Jesus healed, and now all of a sudden it's God's plan. And what's the, there's something that's kind of mixed up about this. Because I'll tell you what, Jesus didn't pack out hillsides, you know, when people were sick and hurting and laying in stretchers, and by giving them a nice pat on the butt and telling them, aren't you encouraged that God's working out his wonderful plan in your life? Y'all just go home and develop good character. Now, if Jesus did not handle it that way, did he?
No.
What did he do to the sick?
Healed him.
He healed him. He didn't just encourage them. He didn't give them some philosophy to believe while they stayed sick. He healed them, and he healed them all, didn't he? So, let me ask you this. When somebody believes in Jesus Christ, who comes to live inside them? Jesus, right? Amen? He comes to live inside of us. And in the heavens, we're inside of him, aren't we? Amen? My spirit is filled with his. So it's like an umbilical cord reaching right up into the heavens. And so in the heavens, I'm inside of him. Myself is represented. He's like my Jesus suit. I get to wear him. Kind of like a pregnant woman, right? I'm not pregnant. Don't look at my belly. I could tell y'all were doing that. So, but that's the way one being comes into this realm. Amen? And it's a beautiful picture. That's how we come into the Father's presence inside of Jesus Christ. And so, how many of you are married and have gone through this whole thing of having a baby in your marriage? Okay. All right. So, the neat thing about it is that I didn't have to muster up extra love when my child came into the world. The love that we shared as man and woman, that same love, my child was right caught up in that. So putting a roof over my wife's head and protecting her, when I protected her, the same protection that she got was the same protection that our child got. Why? Because our child's inside of her. The nourishment that she got, putting food on the table for her, you know what? That was the nourishment that became the nourishment for my child, what I give to her, because he's in there. He's in her, right? We get the same thing, the love that the Father's pouring out to Jesus Christ. We're under that like a waterfall. Amen? And so God's not like treating us separate. We're inside of Him. And He's inside of us. In heaven, we wear our Jesus suit. On the earth, He's wearing His Andy suit. Isn't that nice? So it's no longer us living, but Christ living in us. And it's so there's a lot there. I learned this. I started to learn this when I came back from Turkey. I knew it in the Bible. I knew the verses. But it hadn't really come together in a very profound, simple way for me so that it was living. Up to that point, here's the Christianity that I had. I had a very solid beginning point and a very solid ending point. I knew that if I believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, that my sins were forgiven and that I would be saved, and that one day I was going to end up with God in heaven. Amen? And that when I saw Him as He was, I was going to become just like Him. Amen? But here's the issue, is that you've got all this living to do between those two points. Amen? And here's the way that I was living. I was trying to use the Bible for a bunch of principles and formulas. Learned, here's five principles to pray. And here's five principles about being a good husband. And here's, you know, six principles about being a good leader. And here's principles of evangelism. And here's principles of this and that. And I had all these principles. And you know what I was doing? I didn't even realize it. I was living the good Muslim life. Or I was living the good Jewish life. I had a book from heaven to tell me what to do. But this is what Jesus said. Don't do this. In John chapter 5 or 6. Let's look it up. I think it's 5. My mind is going a little bit blank. But let's go ahead and open the Bible since this is a teaching time, right? I like the Bible. I hope you can tell that. But if you can't tell it yet, you're going to. John chapter 5 verse 39, Jesus says to the Pharisees, He said, "You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, but it's these who bear witness of Me. Yet you won't come to Me so that you may have life." You see that? So Jesus is actually correcting people, not for reading the Scriptures, but because of the way that they're reading the Scriptures. And do you know what? The reason I can say that I was leading the good, the victorious Muslim life is because I've spent a lot of time around people of that faith. And so what I've realized is that for the most part, they're good-hearted people really trying to do the best they can with what they've got. Same as you and me. The problem is what they've got is if we don't realize what we've received more than just a book from God, haven't we? We've also received forgiveness of all of our sins and the very Spirit of God coming to live inside of us. Amen? We don't just have advice and principles to try to pull off this is the best life that you can live, because everybody wants to figure out what is it that God wants so that if I do that, then I've got God's blessings coming at me, right? So we want to be in control of the blessings. We want a book from heaven just telling us this is what we should do. Jesus said, this is what you're doing. You're searching the scriptures because you think that in them you've got life. Right? Just tell me what to do. I'll do it. I'll pull it off and I've got the life, man. Right? How many Christians in America or around the world that's the way they're living? They're trying their best to do what they think God expects of them. And so, but listen, when you're doing good, it's like this. And then when you're doing bad, it's like this. Your walk, your relationship with God, you feel like I'm doing everything I need to, right? And my relationship with God is strong. I'm not doing everything I need to. Oh, woe is me. You know, we've got this, all these dips and bumps and hiccups along the way. Sometimes I come into a group or I'll have a conversation. I have lots of ministry over coffee in living rooms. I feel like that's where a lot of life change really takes place. You know, it's not very glamorous, but those are the conversations that help me understand this, help me put it together. You can have that personal interaction with people that really helps them to get it. And so one of the questions sometimes I'll ask people, I said, well, tell me about your relationship with God. You know what they start telling me about? Well, I've been having a hard time having my quiet times lately, and I've been oversleeping. I'm really tired, and I haven't been able to go to church much. I've been going pretty good, better than it used to be. You know, and they're telling me all about the stuff that they do, right? And I said, I didn't ask you to tell me about your walk with God. Tell me about your relationship with God. And they're like, what's the difference? And I said, that's the problem. You think that your relationship with God is built on your walk with God. It's not. Your walk with God needs to be built on your relationship with God. And the gospel is this, is that God says, I will give you the very same relationship with me that my Son has with me. Amen? That His relationship with me gets to be your relationship with me as a gift for you to enjoy as your relationship with Him. Amen? How righteous is Jesus Christ? Guess what? You get to receive His righteousness as your righteousness. He's so right standing in the eyes of God. How accepted is Jesus in the eyes of the Father? Perfectly accepted. The Father delights in Him. Do you know what? This is the relationship that He's given to us. It says in Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7, it says that God in the fullness of time sent forth His Son, born of woman, born under the law, so that He might redeem those who were under the law. Amen? That's right. So that's that first thing. We've got redemption. By His blood, our sins are washed away, right? But here's where most people go wrong. We always take the gospel and say that it's about where you end up when you die. But if you look in the scriptures, that's not the main emphasis. It's part of the deal. It really is. But I want to let you know that what the gospel is in the scriptures, listen to this, it says He gave Himself to redeem those who are under the law. Why? So that they might receive the adoption as sons. Mm-hmm. He's redeeming us into a relationship, a living relationship. Jesus says that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to where?
Father.
The Father. See, we think, oh, this means that you can't go to be with God unless you have Jesus. I want to let you know, everybody that dies is going to go to God. Some people aren't going to get to stay, though. You need to come to know God as your Father now. Lots of religions has a concept of God, but only through Jesus Christ can you come to know God and come to Him as Father. Amen? So that you can become a son. That's exactly what you're created for. You got? You understand? So what does he do? He gives you a relationship with him. The very same relationship as the Father and the Son, Jesus. He adopts us so that he redeems us so that he can adopt us. Jesus was paying adoption fees. Right? So that he could seal off the records and break all the ties, you know, from the original father. We had a bad father. Jesus said, you're doing what your father, the devil, has always done. You're lying. You hate me. Right? I changed fathers. Amen? When did I do that? When I was born again. Jesus said, you can't come into the kingdom of heaven. John chapter 3, verse 3 and verse 5. He said, you can't see the kingdom of heaven, nor can you enter into it until you are born of God. Until you're born of heaven, born of the Spirit. What's born of flesh is flesh, but what's born of spirit is spirit. Amen? When you receive Jesus Christ, when you put your faith in Him, God gives you a brand new relationship with Him. It's the very same relationship that the Son has with the Father, to be yours forever. Then you walk with God to live out this relationship. Amen? You start with that relationship. This is who I am. I'm righteous. I'm accepted. I'm beloved. I'm delighted in. And therefore, I live in this love. I live it out, and it flows out from me. And not only do I have the relationship, said that He did this so that He would adopt us as sons. Because you are sons, He's put the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Amen? So, if I adopt you, you know, I can give you a relationship that you weren't born into, right? But I can't genetically make you mine. God's a lot better at adoption than I am. Amen? Amen. He actually genetically makes you His. I'm saying that in a spiritual sense. He doesn't change your physical DNA. You're not immaculately conceived. But the very same Spirit of God that entered into the womb of Mary for the Immaculate Conception now enters into your spirit to make you as much a Son of God as Jesus Christ Himself. He had that by His nature. You get it as a gift. Amen? Now, we get to learn to start walking that out. And that fills in this little gap in the middle. Let me ask you this. Could you ever screw up the relationship between the Father and the Son? No. Anything you could ever do really screw that up? You know? You couldn't, could you? Isn't that good? That His relationship with the Father that's so firm and fixed, that becomes your relationship. You get adopted into that so that you can start enjoying His relationship as the one that you are participating in as your relationship. That's amazing. Can you imagine what it would be like for an orphan to be looking in through the windows of families their whole life and seeing the way that this father treated a son, you know? And they saw this. The father and the son began to notice this. And then the father then and the son, they hatched this idea. Dad, I know what's on your heart. You love it, don't you? And the father's like, yes, son. I love having you as a son. Why don't we adopt him? Yeah, let's do it. And they do that. Can you imagine that it would take a little bit of time for that orphan to unlearn their orphan ways, huh? Yeah. Even though they're brought into that relationship, they never experienced this relationship before. Before, all I've known is taking care of me, myself, and I. All I've known is manipulation and rejection control. You know, I don't think about the future. I'm just trying to get by today. Amen? That's the way orphans think. But God gives us something different. He gives us the relationship that Jesus has. I discovered this not long after I came back from Turkey. God made this so real to me. And I started learning that the Christian life isn't me trying my best to live like Jesus. It's Jesus living inside of me, living out through me, as me, in my life. It's really His Spirit is in me. And He does a great job of living the Christian life. He loves His neighbor as Himself. He really doesn't feel rejected. He doesn't feel pressure. He just enjoys being a son. And if there's any pressure, it's water pressure, like on the inside. You know, just, I got so much in me, it's just coming out, guys. You can't, you know, I'm sorry, I forgot about that rule. You're not supposed to talk about Jesus. I just, you know, it just comes out, you know. It's great. My wife, bless her heart, she was She has two moms that she's been meeting with for the past 5-6 months. They've been going through one of the study manuals that we wrote. Two moms, 6 children apiece. Man. And my wife has just been taking them out for coffee. And so she got there and she noticed that there was one lady walked out from the back with a severe limp. And my wife said, "Did you hurt yourself?" She goes, "Oh yeah, I did. I hurt my ankle. I slipped. It's really messing with me." She said, "Let me pray for you real quick." And so the lady's like, "All right." So she put her hand on her, saying, "In Jesus' name right now, be healed. Be healed now." And the lady said, "Wow, thank you." She goes, "It feels better?" She goes, "Yeah, it feels better." I said, "Great." So my wife goes to sit down. The other lady arrives. They're drinking coffee. Then the manager comes over. You know, this is Madison, Wisconsin. You know, we love. So apparently the employee was in the back going, "Hey, this lady prayed for me and my ankle's healed." Well, manager's like, "What? Who prayed for you?" You know, like so the lady's, "Ma'am, you're not allowed to solicit in this store." You know? She said, "You know, I wasn't soliciting, but hey, God bless you." You know, it just comes out. You know, there's no rules on earth against love that really matter. There's no law against love. So you're authorized by heaven to be as loving as you want to be. Yeah. Amen? And anything comes against you, you don't take that to heart like, "Oh, you did something wrong." I was like, they're still living out of the wrong kingdom. You know, what's flesh, what's born of flesh is flesh. What's born of spirit is good, you know? And so it was just wonderful. It was nice. My wife came back and I said, "How'd it go?" She said, "Good. I got an interesting story," you know, but that's the way things are. You know, a lot of times Jesus advanced the kingdom and then all of a sudden there was a little backlash. "You did that miracle on the wrong day." "I'm so sorry." You know, not. Jesus wasn't that way. So I learned that the Christian life was the life that Jesus lived in me. But I had mostly translated that into my relationship with God and the way that I walked. I had an incomplete revelation of who Christ was in me. I forgot that He's Lord. I knew He was Lord of me. I just didn't know He wanted to be Lord through me. I'm used to Jesus being awesome and amazing. I was not thinking that He was ready to be awesome and amazing through me. Then I began to realize, you know what? He got a hold of my heart through compassion. There were some people that I was fellowshipping with that they were in chronic pain. And after a while, the encouragement that I was giving to them about how much God loves them and who they were in Christ and all those things that were true, even though they were true, how many of you know that sometimes the Spirit of truth shows us that's true, but it's not really, you know, there's more, you know, and the Holy Spirit was getting a hold of my heart and it felt empty inside, like I was just repeating things that were real, but there was no life and oomph and power behind them. God wasn't really relating to them that way through me. And I began to feel adjusted. Then just at that time, I was like, "Lord, what is it?" And somebody put a DVD in my hand where there was a man who was basically proclaiming this very same gospel that Christ is, that the Christian life is who Christ is in us and how we live in Him. And it's about loving people and walking in the power and the authority of God. And I was like, "Man, this guy gets it," because they gave it to me saying, this guy sounds like you. And I was like, "Great, man, that's awesome." And it was the first time I ever heard anybody preach like this. And then he gets towards the end of the message, and he turns, he says, "And that's why we heal the sick." And as soon as he said that, my spirit was still going, "Yes." And my mind goes, "But what about this? What about this? What about this?" You know, I had all of them questions and all those doubts, you know. Only people I ever heard talking about healing the sick were on television asking me for my money. Or on 60 Minutes getting exposed for having 15 mansions in four different parts of the world and having affairs on their wives. And I said, you know, just keep me away from that kind of stuff. I'm not interested in being a hypocrite and being fake. I've got no patience for that. I think it's setting the kingdom of God back. But when I looked at the people that I cared about and that I knew and they were hurting, I was like, I knew there was God was doing something. So when I listened to this man, I realized, man, he's just saying, this is just Jesus. And I knew the life that I was living was not my life. I knew the patience was not me. It was Jesus. You understand, patience is not you saying, God, make me patient. He's got no plan for you to be patient. He's got a plan for you to be dead so that Jesus becomes your life. He's really good at being patient. Amen? He's not trying to fix you. If you could be fixable, he wouldn't have crucified you when he crucified Christ. Amen? And put Christ in you to give you a brand new life. Hey, let's just start over. So, he did this. So I see this guy and I was like, Lord, I can't get past that. You know, like, you ever been at a place where you have a hard time answering all the questions in your head, but in your heart of hearts, you know what's right. And I was like, that's why we need Holy Spirit. Because he can work his way around all that little maze and the blocks. He's a river. You throw a rock in the middle of the river don't stop. It goes right around that thing. Amen? Knows how to go. And I was like, Lord, you got to help me. I've got all these questions because I remember being with my wife and laying hands on her because I believed in healing. When I told you, when I went through seminary, one of the things that I made a thorough study, should these things that we see in the New Testament be happening today? You know what happened? I came out of seminary a theologically convinced charismatic that had never experienced the Holy Spirit. But I was convinced all these things should be happening by the Word of God. No experience led me into this. Okay? It was a thorough study of the Word of God. I had the people say, when the perfect comes, all these things will cease, man. Brother, we got the Bible. What? I said, well, it doesn't just say that tongues is going to cease. Guess what else is going to cease? Knowledge and prophecy. And guess what? Goes a couple verses down and it says, and then we'll see him face to face and we'll know him just as we are known. Brother, are you seeing Jesus face to face? You know, I said, that ain't happened yet. If you're going to throw tongues out, you need to throw out knowledge too. Stop your Bible reading. Stop all that reading you're doing, studying. Forget seminary. Give them to refund your tuition. Go on with it. And stop preaching. There ain't going to be no prophecy either. See, I'm getting back to Alabama. I'm getting loosed up with you guys. Sorry. Is that okay? All right. So, anyway, all this stuff happened. And I began to, all these thoughts. I remember laying hands on my wife in Turkey. Father, please heal her. Part of my problem was I believed God could heal her. I believed it should be happening. But believing God can and believing God should is not making doesn't make things work. That's not faith. It's not. It's part of it. But it's... You know, Jesus didn't walk around hoping that God might finally heal somebody. Lord, I want to see again. Well, come here, let me pray for you. Let's see what God might do. It's not the way he approached things. But it's often the way we approach things because we want to give a lot of wiggle room. Because for us, the experience of God's power, the experience of God's healing might be a little bit of hit and miss, right? Maybe some more failures. To see the breakthroughs that we're believing God for, and then we've had successes. So one of the things that we're going to do is level the playing field. We got to come to a basis of what is the foundation for what we believe. Is it your experience or mine? It's the Word of God, isn't it?
Yes.
Amen. Now, saying that, some of you say, well, I've seen a lot of people preaching the Bible and they got different opinions. It's not my opinion of the Word of God. It's the Word of God, right? Now, what I've found is this, is that Bible verses are like puzzle pieces. You can put them together in a lot of different ways, and that's why you get denominations. Amen? Jesus is the cover on the box. Amen? He's the Word made flesh. He is the self-revelation of who God is. And He's the cover on the box. Now, I went to a home meeting one night, and one family had brought their little girl, and she came in with a tub full of Lego pieces. And while we were doing our thing, she was off in the corner building something. It was amazing. Then we broke up at certain points, partnered up in groups, went to different places in the house, and I was kind of monitoring. Everybody got started in the activity real good, and it worked out that I didn't have a partner that night, so I went to go find the Legos, you know. And I'm looking, and this girl's making some elaborate floor plan of something. It was pretty amazing. And I look, and all I see is this jumble of pieces. I couldn't make heads or tails of it. But I saw one piece that had two wheels on either side, and another piece that had two wheels on the other side, and I knew I could get those two, and I could get one little long straight one to connect them, and then I could start to build me a car or a tractor or something like that. So I grabbed a few pieces, and I put them together, and I made a tractor, I think, and I rolled it to her, and I said, "Look what I made." She goes, "That's not right," and took it apart. Why? Because she had seen the cover on the box. She knew what those pieces were intended to look like. What most people do is that they grow up in a denomination, or they grow up with friendships, or they hear different Bible verses, and they see the Bible teaching that's out there, and it just looks like this confusing jumble of a lot of different opinions that has no coherence, no stability to it. So they just look for something that looks familiar. Something I can recognize and get my arms around, right? Well, I'm a single mom, so I need some promises for single mothers, you know. Or I'm a businessman, so I'm going to go learn business principles. And and we get these things, and we put them together in ways sometimes that they just don't look like Jesus, do they? We end up with Christian opinions. There are, quote-unquote, Bible-believing churches that will argue with one another. Amen? There are quote-unquote Bible-believing churches that believe that they have, that believe it's the right thing to do to protest funerals, saying that God hates your child and it's a good thing that they're dead and they're in hell now. And they have Bible verses. Every time you would argue with them, they'll throw a little Bible verse back to justify this is the approach that we should take. Well, you know what? You get one person with a bunch of Bible verses over here, and another person with a bunch of another Bible verse over there, and at the end of the day, you just toss it up and it's like, who's right? Who, you know, guys, Jesus is the Word made flesh. Amen. He is the self-revelation of God. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. You want to know something else that's cool? If you've seen Him, you've not only seen the Father, you've seen yourself, your Christian life. Because Colossians chapter 3, verse 4 says, when Christ, who is your life, is revealed, you will be revealed with Him also in glory. Paul said, it's not me living this life, it's Christ living in me. Amen? Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Who does these things? I live by the faith of the Son of God. Let me ask you this. What did Jesus believe about healing? See, believing like Jesus gets you saved. You get born again. Believing in Jesus gets you saved, gets you born again. Amen? When you believe in Him. But when you grow up into His image, you start believing like Jesus. Amen? To walk like a son, you need to start believing like the Son. Your mind was not to have your own opinions, your own perspective, your own thoughts. Your mind was to be filled with the mind of Christ. Let this mind that dwelled in Him dwell in you also. We have received the mind of Christ. Do you know that your heart was meant to cry out with His heart? God has put in Galatians chapter 4 that we were just talking about. Therefore, since you are sons, God's put the Spirit of His Son into your heart, crying, Abba, Father. Man, it's not hard for Jesus to cry out in intimacy to the Father and to express love and trust and faith in the Father, is it? Now, you might feel like, well, I've just been handicapped my whole life because my dad was this and my mom was this and I've just never been able to blah, blah, blah. Okay, great. That was crucified. I know it feels really alive inside of you, but you can be free from that because Jesus has already died for it, okay? So instead of repeating the old messages that you learned while you were an orphan, how about you step into the Father's presence as a son, say, just pretend for a little bit that God loves you with the same love that He gives to Jesus, that God receives you in the same way that He receives Jesus, that God has, and when you start to pretend a little bit, you'll find Holy Spirit's not pretending at all. That joy and that peace that comes into you and that power that comes in the inside starts flowing out through you. Amen? Amen. Sometimes I'll tell people, when we get to train in on healing the sick, do you understand that this is the foundation? This is the foundation, because if we don't see it in Jesus, how did He relate to sickness and disease? That shows us the Father. And we have a lot of people that have a lot of questions because they're taking Bible verses from all different places in Scripture. And listen, I believe that the Scripture, all Scripture is inspired by God. Amen? But there's a reason that we don't go up to the temple and sacrifice lambs on Passover. Right? It says that the law was revealed in Moses, John chapter 1, verse 14, or 15, 17, 17. John chapter 1, verse 17 says that the law came through Moses, but grace and truth has come through Jesus Christ. Amen? So there was a fullness of God that was not revealed until Jesus showed up. You got it? The creation shows us that God's creator, that He's wise and powerful. Amen? And then Moses shows us the righteousness of God. Amen? The law, the authority. Right? And then Jesus shows us the grace and truth, the fullness of God. So now God has come in person. Let me show you who I really am. I've been wanting to do this for a long time. You know? So, all right. So that's the beginning pieces. I started to see at this point, Jesus heals the sick, but He's not healing the sick through me. And at that point, I had been thinking up to that point, wow, I must not have that gift, right? Or we need to pray and beg and ask God, you know, we need to get God stirred up again. Before, you know, in Acts chapter 2 and during the Bible days, God was really with it, you know, but now seems like God's not with it anymore. So maybe we need to worship a little bit harder, pray a little bit more, get God up, you know, get Him working again. You know, get Him back in the gym. Go, God, go! Do something! But that didn't seem right either, did it? Sounds stupid when I say it, but you guys know that there's whole streams of Christianity that's their whole mindset. Okay? I'm not making fun of it. I'm just, for me, you got to understand, I'm not making fun of my brothers and sisters, but we'll do a lot of things. I mean, it sounds like an orphan to say, God, please come. Amen? And God's like, I'm right here. You know, I'm here. I'm with you. You know, I want you to realize this. So, make a long story short, my mind changed because of the Bible, but I had to grow into that understanding of not just believing in Jesus, but start to believe like Jesus. Okay, so that's part of what this conference is really going to be about, is exposing the many, many mindsets. Because when I go places to equip believers to walk in the power of God, what I see oftentimes, and this conference is specifically really focused in on healing a lot. It's the Divine Healing Technician school training through John G. Lake Ministries. So this has been refined over years. This is what John Lake taught to his technicians, so, because he said healing is not a gift, it's the power and the authority of the kingdom that will operate through any believer who will walk in these principles. They were principles that I learned from the Bible, and he could teach it to other people, and when they began to do it, it began to operate in them too. So you need to understand that this is like electricity. If you understand the properties and principles of electricity, it just happens. Amen? It's not hard for electricity to have power, but we got to know how to work with that so that we can understand that. And God's not a mindless force, but God has a nature and a character that He's revealed. He's filled with compassion. He's got awesome power. Amen? And He does not like sickness and disease. Contrary to what you may have been told, God's not trying to use it in your life. He's trying to get it out of you. Mm-hmm. Amen? Amen? So, why don't we do this? We'll take a quick, maybe 5-10 minute break. Let everybody get their second win for the night. While we're on break, one of the things I want to point out is that the book table in the back has got a lot of resources. There is a manual for the conference back there. It's about that thick on a binder. That's the only thing on the table that was not written by me. That was written by the leader of our ministry, adapted from the manual that he received that John Lake actually wrote. He just kind of filled it out to address some of the issues that we're dealing with today that weren't around back in John Lake's day. That's $25. The rest of the stuff is cheaper than that on the table. Most of the books are $15. There's one fat one that is $20, but the rest of them are $15. So well, let's take a 10-minute break, and then we'll start up for our last session for this evening. Okay? Oh. One last thing. If you came in with questions that you want to be addressed, I've got some index cards here. If you want to write some questions during the break, please tear one of these off and write your question, put it there, and we'll start the next session answering some questions. I want to make sure that you can do that. Okay, so these are right up here for everybody.